Democrats want to add new evidence to the impeachment trial, evidence laid out by indicted Rudy Giuliani associate Lev Parnas. Speaking with our Anderson Cooper, Parnas said he worked with Giuliani to force Ukraine's hand in announcing an investigation of Joe Biden. He talked about quid pro quo demands, implicated Vice President Mike Pence, and said that President Trump was personally involved, especially when it came to the firing of U.S. Ambassador to Ukraine, Marie Yovanovitch. Take a listen.
Why did they hate her?
Because she was supposed to be a Soros left. She was supposed to be a leftover from the Obama Soros Democrat era, and that she was.
That's what you were told.
That's what I was told. That she's not a Trumper. And to my knowledge, the president fired her at least four times, maybe even five times. I mean, once in my presence.
Yeah, explain that. You said that he fired her in front of you.
Correct.
What happened?
That was the first interaction about her. We had it was a dinner at the private dinner for a super PAC in Washington, D.C. at the Trump Hotel. And in the conversation, the subject of Ukraine was brought up, and I told the president that our opinion that she is bad-mouthing him, and that she said that he's going to get impeached, something like that. I don't know if that's word for word, but that she was...
You said that at the table?
Correct.
Where the president
correct,
was?
Correct, correct. And his reaction was he looked at me, like, got very angry, and basically turned around to John DeStefano and said, fire her, get rid of her.
John DeStefano is a counselor to the president who left the White House in late May. He announced his resignation May 20th, which was also Marie Yovanovitch's last day as ambassador of Ukraine. Well, after the new evidence emerged suggesting Yovanovitch may have been illegally surveilled before being fired, it took Secretary of State Mike Pompeo more than 48 hours to even acknowledge the allegations. On the radio program The Tony Katz Show, the secretary said the State Department would be investigating.
I've not met this guy, Lev Parnas, to the best of my knowledge. I've never encountered, never communicated with him. We will do everything we need to do to evaluate whether there was something that took place there. I suspect that much of what's been reported will ultimately prove wrong. But our obligation, my obligation as Secretary of State, is to make sure that we evaluate, investigate any time there's someone who posits that there may have been a risk to one of our officers. We'll obviously do that.
John Hudson is a national security reporter focusing on the State Department and diplomacy for the Washington Post. So, John, if, as the secretary just said, we just heard him in his own words there, he says it's his obligation to investigate a potential risk, why would it take him nearly 3 days to announce that?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, right now he has taken a see no evil, hear no evil approach, saying he didn't know Lev Parnas, never communicated with Lev Parnas, wasn't even aware of any type of surveillance, illicit surveillance under one of his former ambassadors. So there are questions about why it took so long. You know, his point person for external communications, Katie Martin, has not been responding to questions about this process. And so it has left a lot of people wondering, especially as the Ukrainian government said that they would launch an investigation into any illicit surveillance that was happening on Ukrainian soil. So it was a significant event that he said that he is going to investigate it, look into it. It's clear that he is has doubts about the veracity of these things. And I think there is some legitimacy to some of the skepticism. You know, as you know, Lev Parnas does not have a sterling reputation, either does the pro-Trump congressional candidate who is the associate in this case. So there's a lot of questions about what type of surveillance this was. And the State Department is now saying they'll look into it, but they're coming from a place of skepticism right now.
Well, we'll see what that finds. I think it's important, too, though, as we're looking at all of this, to really step back, because any diplomats overseas, especially if you're in Ukraine, right, there's probably some sense that you need to know that you're being watched. You also expect to be protected by the State Department. So at the heart of this allegation is the fact that a U.S. ambassador was allegedly being surveilled and her safety was at risk. Just put into context for us how concerning that could be or should be.
Well, it would be absolutely concerning. And the State Department has a massive bureaucracy in place called the Bureau of Diplomatic Security that is put in place just for this matter of making sure that our top diplomats who are posted around the world are not being spied upon, they're not being tracked. These people are ones who need to represent the United States around the world with confidence and know that their personal safety is ensured, and that their movements and it, to some extent their communications are secure, and they can communicate back to Washington, and they can deal with their interlocutors in a way that is safe. And especially in a country like Ukraine, which is a U.S. ally, you would expect the U.S. ambassador there to be in a safe place. So you're absolutely right. This is a strange scenario. It's a strange allegation. And that's why, you know, some people were looking for the department to immediately acknowledge that they would be looking into it. Took a little bit of time, but now you have Pompeo saying, yes, they are going to look into it.
I also want to ask you about this. There's a new excerpt today from your colleague's new book, A Very Stable Genius, about the president. And in this excerpt that was published, we learn about a meeting that was called 6 months in to the president's term to essentially educate the president and to try to rein him in, to not just explain history to him, but the way, you know, international relations work, certainly from the role of the president on down. He reportedly responded to a lot of it by not only calling the assembled brass in the room losers, but said they're, quote, a bunch of dopes and babies. So the advisors who had called that meeting are gone. We know the president goes his own way. He's demonstrated that again and again. There's increasingly less pushback within the administration. What's fascinating to me, and I'm just wondering if you're learning anything from your reporting, is the fact that we still are not hearing more from former officials. And I'm talking about even people like Rex Tillerson, people who are not running for office, who don't necessarily have anything to lose, and yet they are silent. But some of them were concerned enough to put together this meeting.
Yeah, well, that's a very interesting point. You're absolutely right that there are this team, a sort of alumni network of former officials who clearly had grave concerns and significant differences with the president on foreign policy. And the segment that you were just referring to, this tank meeting, was a moment where those officials tried to get together and try to impart their views on President Trump, and it totally backfired. Now, the question of why aren't they speaking up more right now, I think that we've seen that the president has very credibly enforced his motto, which is he always punches back. So even when there has been relatively restrained remarks from former Secretary of State Rex Tillerson about some of the concerns, some of the things he experienced while he was in government, Trump has ferociously shot back at him, calling him dumb as a rock, and really criticizing him in some of the worst ways you might expect, and ways that you would not normally expect of a former Secretary of State. These are supposed to be elder statesmen at this point, yet they're still getting in Twitter feuds with the President of the United States. And so I think that has been some of the reason why you've seen a sort of quiet from the former officials, his former chiefs of staff, his former Secretary of State, why they haven't been particularly vocal in their now private lives.
Still fascinating, though, isn't it? John Hudson, appreciate your insight. Thank you.
Thanks.